happening followed by iodination to give this CH2, which then hydrolyzes to give the formylated derivative in this case. If water is present, in that case this is very well known reaction that alkynes can go to allene, the isomerization, and this alkyne-allene isomerization then leads to the cyclization of this exo-ene compound that adds to this isomerization take place, aromatization, and you get a methylated compound in this case. So this water in water aqueous medium, this isomerization is there, and therefore we are getting the methyl derivative. Another important reaction in recent year is the sulfinylation of imidazopyridine, and several reports have been there on the sulfinylation of imidazopyridine using different sulfinylating reagents. Most of them are based on the pre-synthesized imidazopyridine, and there are no reports on the base mediated CH bond formation in these reactions. So we looked at some literature that thiols have been used as a sulfinylating reagent either in presence of iodine or in presence of a base to sulfinylate this type of active methylene compound. And as we were doing this, so we thought that if in situ this cyclizes to the active methylene compound and it can undergo the sulfinylation. So we again optimized the reaction condition, and we found that in KOH, presence of KOH at room temperature, this reaction, the tandem reaction happens. First the cyclization takes place and then the sulfinylation takes place to give this compound in 73% yield. We looked at a different sulfinylating reagent for this and found that the disulfide and thiophenols work very well in this condition, but other sulfinating reagents are not giving the desired product in good yield. So this is a substrate scope. You can have different thiophenols here, and in most of the cases the yields are good, except the ortho-bromo case where the yield was little low. And we have confirmed the structure of the compound by crystal analysis. Then we also looked into the substrate scope of the imidazopyridine, the aminopyridine derivative, as well as into the thiophenols, and got a very good yield of these compounds. To confirm the mechanism of this, we found that when we have this and thiophenol in acetonitrile, no base, we don't get any product. In presence of base, if you don't have that aminopyridine, only thiophenol gets, you get a dimerization. This is disulfide, it's a very well known reaction, oxidation of thiophenols in presence of base. And when we have this in presence and KOH, we get this cyclized compound. Therefore, we are proposing that this cyclized compound either reacts with disulfide or with thiophenol to give the, which we have done some more experiment to prove that. And when we did a tempo, when we added tempo, the reaction gets almost stopped. You get a, when 4 equivalent tempo is used, we get 0% yield, and we isolated, we found in reaction mass formation of this sulfon and tempo complex. So this is there. That indicates that reaction is going involving a free radical formation. And we propose that in presence of base, this gets cyclized to this ketone. And then in presence of base, this forms anion, and sulfide thiophenol gets oxidized to disulfide, and that undergoes the sulfination to give this ketone, which can tautomerize to the 2-hydroxyimidazopyridine. We also looked into this application that if you have hydroxy here, now you can functionalize it to tosylate, and then you can do Suzuki reaction and many more. So you can get a 2-aryl-ated different sulfinylated compound here. We also found that when we are using iodine, we can use sulfinate as a sulfinating reagent in this case, and this reaction also works very well with different sulfinates and aminopyridine again. So another important reaction is that if you see the drug molecules, you have CH2NH derivative in all of them. Here we have developed a simple method for aminomethylated compounds, and the condition here is TBHP and indium SO. Interestingly, TBHP is doing a dual role here. one is it acts as an oxidant, other it provides the CH2 carbon of this. This CH2 comes from the TBHP. So again different substituted imidazopyridine were taken. Reaction work with the methoxyamine aryl group as well as with nitroaryl group very well, except when this reaction did not work when CF3 was just at C2 position. Otherwise, the tertiary butyl also it worked very well. With heterocycle, it worked very well. And then we also looked into different aminopyridines for this, and C2, the different substituted aminopyridine worked very well with this. 4 aminopyridine also worked, but the yield was relatively lower as compared to the 2 aminopyridine. 3 aminopyridine did not work in this case, and then aminopyridines also worked very well in this reaction. So this, when we did the reaction in DMSO, we took a deuterated DMSO and we got a CH2 here. That also confirms indirectly that DMSO is not the source of carbon here, but a TBHP is the source of carbon. In case of TEMPO, when we did a reaction, this methylated TEMPO was observed in mass, and the other product were, when we took DPE as a scavenger here, we also got some of the DPE substituted aminopyridine. That means that there is a radical formation from that. So this, when we took CH3 methylated C3 methyl imidazopyridine, the reaction did not work. Only there was oxidation of CH3 and there was a cleavage of the imidazopyridine ring under this condition, and which is also a reported method. TBHP cleaves the imidazopyridine if you use excess of this. But when we took N-methyl aminopyridine, reaction in TBHP reaction worked very well in this condition. So the mechanism was proposed that methyl radical from TBHP reacts with 2 aminopyridine and forms N-methyl aminopyridine. That reacts, forms iminium ion, and that iminium ion reacts with the imidazopyridine to give the aminomethylated compound. Another interesting reaction is the dicarbonylation of imidazopyridine, and there have been a lot of interest in this also in recent years using different dicarbonylated compound or methyl ketones. Most of these reactions are using the metal catalyzed reaction. And we were just some master student, I asked to do this reaction, and I was surprised to see that though all these phenyl glyoxal, they have done this dicarbonylation using metal catalyzed reaction. We just added this in acetic acid and we get a dicarbonylated compound in very good yield, almost single spot in the reaction. And if you take this glyoxal, then you get a dicarbonylated and diimidazopyridine compound. We propose that this is my kind of Friedel-Crafts addition, electrophilic addition to the this ketone group, and then the oxidation is taking place. Interestingly, this don't give a aryl compound with benzaldehyde, but it works with the dicarbonylated compound. So we looked into the substrate scope and different dicarbonylated compound with heterocycle as well as with a substituted imidazopyridine works very well in this condition. We also have dicarbonylated compound here. So with this I summarized that we could functionalize imidazopyridine and we could synthesize some of the functionalized imidazopyridine under metal free condition in this case. I would like to thank my PhD student who have contributed in this work, specifically Hema and Nitesh, and MSc student last work was done by Manu Srivastava. And one of them aminomethylated work was done by a postdoc Dr. Om Patel. I'm also thankful to my collaborator for initially helping us in different analytical work, as well as Professor Dalip Kumar, my colleague at BITS Pilani, who actually mentored initially at BITS Pilani and always helped us to do some good work at department. Definitely, funding is very important for this work. So, BITS Pilani for the infrastructure facility, served CSC, CSIR, UGC for project finding. Thank you for your kind attention.
Questions from the students first. Anybody? At least one? Yeah. You raised your hand, you know? Last one, no? All right. Now, anybody else? Yeah.
In one of the mechanisms, you are sharing the role of methylpyridine. So, did you take N-methylpyridine itself and then?
Yes. Yes.
What was the outcome of that?
And we got the product. Yes. So, if you look at the last reaction, we took N-methylaminopyridine with the this substrate. Under CBHP, under same condition, we got the product in 70%.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
So this really nice work actually. So this oxidation, have you tried to look into that more deeply? You are saying that that is getting oxidized just with acetic acid, you are getting the oxidation, right? So initially there is one loss of water molecule showing, and then the other CH2 is getting oxidized. So it is just air oxidation that is happening, or
it's air. We are just doing acetic acid, the dicarbonylated compound, and imidazopyridine we are adding, heating it at 100 degree, and we are getting a product.
Okay, so it is just air oxidation that you are doing.
But it don't work with simple benzaldehyde or simple aldehydes. We are not getting aroylated or acylated compound.
So the adjacent carbonyl group is. Once the dehydration takes place from the diol, you get the adjacent.
Some role is there. We are still
adjacent carbon group.
We have made a substrate, but we are looking into how it is happening.
Okay.
All right. That means that that is the end of this particular session. Any other question? If there are no more questions, let's thank both speakers of the session.
With this, we come to the end of this technical session. Bhartiya Chair Professor, School of Chemistry, University of Hyderabad, Professor Govardhan Mehta, an alumnus of Wits Pilani, has been conferred over a dozen honorary doctorate degrees by universities in India and abroad. He is an internationally acclaimed researcher with wide-ranging research interests in organic chemistry and specializes in design of complex molecules that blends art and architecture, and has published more than 450 original research papers in international journals of high repute. An advocate of quality and reforms in Indian universities, Professor Mehta served as the Director of Indian Institute of Science and as Vice Chancellor of the University of Hyderabad, and has also held faculty position at the Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur. Professor Mehta was the Srinivas Ramanujan Research Professor of the Indian National Science Academy and CSIR Bhatnagar Fellow. He is a recipient of over 40 national and international awards that include the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize, G.D. Birla Award for Excellence in Science, Centenary Medal of Royal Society of Chemistry, London, Trieste Science Prize from TWAS, Italy, Humboldt Research Prize from Germany, medals from Indian Chemical Society, Indian National Science Academy and Indian Science Congress Association, and has been honoured with Padma Shri by the Government of India and the Chevalier de la Legion d'Honneur by President of the Republic of France. A Fellow of the Royal Society and foreign member of the Russian Academy of Sciences, has been a President of the Indian National Science Academy, Co-Chair of Inter-Academy Council and President of International Council for Science, and is actively associated with a large number of national and international organizations. Professor Mehta serves as Independent Director in the Board of Directors and as member of research advisory boards of several leading pharmaceutical and biotech companies. It is an honor to have you amongst us today, Professor Govardhan Mehta.
Control this. very embarrassing, you know. Only good part is that my wife is here, so she may have a better opinion of me. So let me say a few things when it is. You know, I must say that it's very kind of you to have this little video. But I must tell you that whenever you raise expectations, be sure that disaster awaits you. And you have seen what happened with Tendulkar, and you know what recently is happening with Virat Kohli. When you expect him to do well, he lets you down. And this is the part of the tradition that many of us follow. I hope and wish me well that I will not let you down. Okay, we had a feast full of chemistry today. We had many outstanding state-of-the-art presentations of research in chemistry. So you have seen the hard side of chemistry. What I am going to present to you will be the soft side of chemistry. And all of you know very well that it's only when there is a good gelling, good complementarity between the hard side and the soft side that the best comes out. Very true of use of IT tools. Hardware alone will be nothing, but if software is right, it matches the hardware, then of course you can play and you can make wonders. So I will be giving a talk not about research in chemistry, but I am going to talk today about chemistry. What is our science? How it has come where we stand today? What is its future? And is there something we collectively, as practitioners of chemistry, as practitioners of science, can ensure a sustainable future for our branch of science? Let me therefore first highlight the question that I have here. I am going to talk about enablers both of chemistry and chemists. Because it is chemists who make chemistry. And both chemists and chemistry have to work in tandem if our discipline has to advance. So I will have something to say about chemistry as well as chemists, but they are blended together. So you will not be able to segregate chemists from chemistry, which is obvious and this is understandable. So, let me tell you why I decided to talk about this. You know, when this symposium was being planned, Professor Bansal called me and I thought he rightly assumed that I am not doing any research. But he said, why don't you give a lecture on ethics in chemistry? Well, ethics is not only the domain of chemistry. Ethics is all pervasive in every facet of life, certainly very important in science. And particularly as we live in this post-truth era, where everything seems to be fake, from the tweets that you read every morning, from the president of a big country, to people writing in newspapers. Fake, everything is preceded by fake. And therefore, it is very important to have an understanding and appreciation of the ethical aspect of our life, of practice of science and practice of chemistry. But I thought that only talking about ethics for 30 minutes or 40 minutes will be inflicting very heavy punishment on the audience. So you will see some facets of ethics and ethical values, but it is embedded in a big frame. So you will be looking at a big frame, but you will also get the flavor of the importance of ethical values. So Professor Bansal, I have obeyed you in some ways, so I'll be referring to some aspects of ethical science. Where are we? Okay. So I am going to present you a bouquet of matters that matter. And in this bouquet you will see variety of words that I have mentioned. It's not normally the part of vocabulary of a chemist, or for that matter even of a scientist. So I will be talking about responsibility in chemistry, humility in by chemists, systems approach to practice of chemistry, directions, ideas, icons, and so on and so forth. So all these words, keywords, will figure in my presentation. Something. That's why I decided not to use remote, but still it is bothering. So I think Kumaraswamy set the tone. And those of you who can understand this French expression I have written, is going to be a mix of many, many things. I think I can only ask you to recollect this very nice cartoon that he showed, which showed mixing many things, and I hope I'll be able to do some kind of a job in mixing these various things. So you will see that I'll be jumping areas, I'll be jumping things, but I hope you will find that I have some messages. So let me start. Chemistry ought not to be for the chemist alone. I think this is something we must remember. This is not a chemist's quote. Miguel Unamuno was a 19th century Spanish philosopher, but he could see the importance of chemistry by even not being a chemist. Chemistry is for everybody. And some of us wrote an editorial in Science few years back, which is reference is shown here, whose title is Chemistry Embraced by All. Chemistry is for everybody. The importance of chemistry we do not fully recognize and also celebrate, because it is too close to us. When something is too close to us, you don't recognize and you don't celebrate. I want to present two... Something is not right. Yeah. I show you the dimensionality of chemistry. What I have here is an imaginary chem connectome, which shows in the backdrop of the imaginary neural network in human brain. Chemistry has as many connectivities as there is a neuronal connectivity in the human brain. So the point I want to convey to you is that the scope of chemistry is unlimited. In fact, only a part of it has been explored, a major part of it is still to be explored. There is another good reason why something is not right, you know, somebody, okay. There is another reason why you should study chemistry. And I have a quote here from Linus Pauling, you know, 2 times Nobel Prize winner, chemistry and peace. What did he have to say? I feel sorry for people who don't know anything about chemistry. They are missing an important source of happiness. So if you see anybody who is unhappy, ask him to study chemistry. The very fact that I see so many cheerful faces in the audience is because you are all students, learners of chemistry. Okay, it's important to ask, where did chemistry come from? Chemistry, as we know today, actually has been practiced from time immemorial. Very simple. It's not about atoms and molecules that it started with. It was an art and craft of mixing substances. Then, in the 15th century, in a giant leap of faith, when modern science was born, often called Baconian science, science based on reason, science based on reproducibility, and science based on rationality. Chemistry jettisoned its tag of alchemy and became chemistry. Robert Boyle is supposed to have given the coined the name chemistry sometime in the 16th century. Then another major advance came in the early part of 20th century, beginning in the late part of 19th century, when an entire discipline could be compressed into a leaflet, the so-called periodic table. It might have given you, many of you, perhaps every learner of chemistry, sleepless nights remembering atomic number, atomic weights, diagonal relationships, periods, groups, and so on. And I know many of you, some are smiling because many of you hate the periodic table. I will have something more to say about the periodic table, but I will at the moment remind you, many of you don't know, 2019 has been declared by United Nations as International Year of Periodic Table of Chemical Elements. 2011 was International Year of Chemistry. It is very, very rare that United Nations, within a span of the same decade, identifies two themes related to a discipline as international years. I will have something to say about it little later. And of course, as you know, that in the 20th century mostly, molecularization of chemical matter took place, and therefore chemistry in some ways was reborn as molecular science. Okay, so this is our past. What happened in the century gone by? Chemistry was recognized for most of the 20th century. It is still to some extent being recognized as a science which has enormous capability to deliver value-added products from almost anything and everything. And you see here, I've deliberately shown here, sand, fire and water. The elements that you see all around you, each one of them can be transformed into value-added products. Only chemists can do. And you will see some examples as I move ahead. When molecular understanding developed, chemistry became a core science. When interdisciplinarity came to the forefront, now I am already entering the era of 1970s onwards, then chemistry became an integrative science. And in the 21st century, end of the 20th century, chemistry has acquired the form of sustainability science. In fact, it will not be unfair to refer to chemistry as sustainability science. And this is because of the serious challenge that our planet faces because of resource stress. And I'm going to talk about it. We have tried to, we wrote an editorial again in Nature Chemistry where we tried to highlight what role chemistry can play to make our planet sustainable. There are many, many features. You will see few flashes of that, but at least out of the 17 goals that United Nations have put in place for achieving sustainability by 2050, six or seven of them interface directly with chemical sciences and chemistry. Okay, let's look at what is chemistry like? What are the evolving realities? I just want to give you one figure. It is estimated that by 2050, 200 billion tons per annum of natural resources will be processed because they will be needed. Currently, we are somewhere around 100 billion tons of chemical processing every year, which is done on our planet. This rate of utilizing natural resources is unsustainable. I'm not dreaming. I'll give you just two examples to tell you why this is unsustainable. Carbon dioxide concentration has already crossed the 400 ppm threshold. In fact, as of last week, it was 412 ppm. And I don't have to dwell upon it. I can give a separate lecture if you wish someday how carbon dioxide concentration is related to the projected 2-degree temperature rise by the end of this century, which now, by most recent estimates, is likely to happen much before, certainly 1.5-degree temperature rise by 2050. And therefore, we cannot afford to have more carbon dioxide going into the atmosphere. The second reason is rapid depletion of many elements like lithium, often referred to as white gold, is rapidly depleting. If you see these graphics, you will see that there will be no lithium ore available for lithium mining by the end of this century. There is, and I tell you the importance of lithium, there is no pocket in this room which does not have a lithium battery as of now. And this is true of many other things that I'm not going to dwell upon. Same thing is happening for rare earths, because rare earths are the basic input in making all electronic materials, including your mobiles and television sets and so on. And rare earths has many other geopolitical challenges, because 90% supply of rare earths is controlled by one country. But the more important is that there will be no rare earths left. So this is a major challenge. And therefore, we have to see that the resources are judiciously used and are sustainable. And you will see this. And I will highlight the role that chemistry can play. Chemistry can pave the way. It will be fundamental by greener, leaner, nimble, and efficient processing. And this is the theme on which I will dwell for next 5 minutes or 7 minutes. You know, Liebig, the famous German chemist, who gave this fantastic model of academia-industry interface, often referred to as Liebig's model, which survived for almost 200, 300 years, perhaps mainly responsible for the rise of Germany as a powerful engine of chemical industry and therefore of economy. He made a statement: growth is controlled not by the total amount of resources available, but by the scarcest resource. And you know, you can see this Liebig's barrel here, which shows that it is the scarcest resource which is the most important. It is so regrettable that chemists have forgotten what Liebig said. You know, those who take a course in management today, read Liebig's law in a different way. All management graduates, the familiar words that they use are more from less, resource prudence, and no longer cradle to grave, the often repeated expression, is tenable. It's now from cradle to cradle. And cradle to cradle is something that only chemists can make it possible. And you will see how one can make. I want to give you, therefore, plead with you, stop using the word waste. Waste is an opportunity. Waste is a challenge. And I will tell you how you should rename waste in future. Things are already happening, and I'll give you just two examples. Apple, the famous phone maker, announced last year that from April, they said that from 2019 they will not use anything which is freshly mined from Earth. So how will the Apple phones come? They will all come from recycling of materials. And therefore, how will you do the recycling? You will only do using chemistry. Adidas, famous sportswear brand, they have said that they will not use in their shoes, t-shirts, and many other goods for which they are famous, they will only use freshly recycled polyester. You know, these are baby steps, but this shows how future will look like. Two of the very well-known brands have decided to do this. Okay. So I already told you, a new paradigm. Waste does not exist. There is only post-trash. And how you approach this is to firmly recognize that chemical matter only changes form. So waste is actually a material awaiting further use. And it is quite possible that someday we live in a world which will be enabled by chemistry alone, mostly, that when you are born, you will be given a gift of 50 kilograms or so of chemical matter. Use it the way you want to in the rest of your life. That's it. And leave it in some form for posterity. And you know, today, the developments and advances which are taking place in chemical manufacturing, for example, this is possible. You know what are the cutting-edge things in chemical manufacturing. AI tools will tell you how to make chemicals. You will use 3D printing to print your own vessels yourself. And then you will use the flow chemistry and related techniques to make it in the anteroom of your bedroom. So such a scenario may appear out of context, but such scenario is not in the realm of impossibility. That's the message I want. Okay. So again, remember, we need to stop thinking of any materials as being waste, and the very concept of waste matter should disappear. We just written an article, hopefully somebody will find it worthwhile to publish it in next few months. And why I'm talking about this again and again? Those of you who follow advances in economics, those who have followed what happened in the recent World Economic Forum in Davos, one word which was repeatedly mentioned was emergence of circular economy, which I have depicted here. This is not my original thing, I have just copied it from internet. And the recent issue of Nature actually highlighted the importance of circular economy. What will be the bedrock of circular economy? Circular economy will only be possible through circular chemistry. There's no other way that circular economy can thrive. And of course, you know these R3 paradigms, reduce, reuse, recycle. These will guide the sustainability of our planet. So my proposition to you, and please young people, remember this, to secure a sustainable future, recognize there is no waste. Circular chemistry is going to be the way forward. And we are now in an era where make, use, dispose things which has played havoc on our environment for last two centuries, and we chemists are very much part of it, is now coming to an end. And we are on the cusp of onset of a new era, which will be reuse, refurbish, re- and upscale era. So as you grow up, adopt this. Practice the chemistry the way it should be. Okay. I told you that 2019 is International Year of the Periodic Table, and I just show you the periodic table which has now been proposed by UN and also by UCHEM, European Chemical Societies. They recently met and adopted this periodic table. In the red you will see are elements which are facing serious threat. In yellow you will see rising threat. Our better part of the day was spent on phosphorus. I just want to remind you that phosphorus is in yellow. Okay. Just to ensure that you have access to this, you can access this periodic table on the internet very readily. And I don't know whether you will get, if you answer some questions on periodic table based on this, it's very likely that you will flunk, because it still has not percolated widely. Why is this important? We take for granted our elemental resources. We don't recognize that our elemental resources are finite. The legacy of elements that we have was bestowed to us 14 billion years ago from this event. This event is not going to repeat, if it is going to repeat, if ever, none of us will be around. So no Big Bang is likely. Even my friends in astrophysics tell me that there could be a neutron star burst, there could be a black hole coming and hitting the universe or our planet, but there will be no Big Bang, because to forge these elements we need temperatures of 10^9 Kelvin. And I must also say, you can read an editorial that we recently wrote. This is the first editorial on the International Year of Periodic Table, which appeared in Current Science on January 9th to commemorate the beginning of the International Year. Okay, let's switch to something else. What you see here is what I call the gallery of legends. Gallery of legends of chemistry. All the great chemists about whom you have read in the past century, past several centuries, figured in this, and I'm not going to talk about it. Each one can be a subject matter of a lecture, and there are a lot of learnings from that. I want to share with you some prophecies. We talked today about sustainability and how chemical matter can be recycled. Lavoisier, probably the father of modern chemistry. Lavoisier said way back in the 17th century, what did he say? Nothing is lost, nothing is created, everything is transformed. This is the foundational principle of chemistry. But we don't seem to follow it and don't seem to fully recognize it. Kekulé, again, somebody who gave us the benzene structure, and you all know about his dream about serpent and so on, said it in German. I will not read it in German because I have terrible pronunciation in German. I will translate this for you, which basically means that chemistry is the learning and science of metamorphosis of matter. So our founding fathers had shown us the way. We seem to have distorted the vision that they showed us. There's a lot of talk for the last 3-4 decades, green, green, green. If you can't get a research grant on the idea that you have, prefix it with green. Very likely that you will get it, because it is green. People don't realize green is in the DNA of chemistry. Why do I say this? I have not seen the color of DNA of chemistry. But what I know is that the person who started modern chemistry, making things in the laboratory and so on, who made the first, and this is again, my young friends, you should know, the first molecule ever made in the laboratory was the most important molecule known to humankind. Wohler made urea. And I can tell you, if urea was not available, none of us will be sitting here. Because the capacity of our earth to fix nitrogen for producing our food is only for 2 billion people. Today, we are nearing 8 billion people. And the 8 billion people of the world are fed because we have urea. Anyway, that's a different story. What I will tell you here is that the very first synthesis was the greenest synthesis. And Wohler wrote to his teacher, Berzelius, about his achievement, not in big papers or something. He said, ammonium cyanate is urea. 100% conversion from starting material to the product. No chemical reagent is used. No solvent is used. You simply heat ammonium cyanate and you get urea. I am still to see a better synthesis today. Although we have made so many advances, we claim, in chemistry, in synthesis, in transformation of matter. So please remember, green is in the DNA of chemistry. But I must also tell you, wherever there is a DNA, mutations are possible. And we see a lot of ill effects of DNA mutations. So chemists have also inherited some mutations which are worrisome. Don't take it very seriously, take it lightly, because I just want to tell you, if it reminds you of similar situations in your life, if it reminds you of some of your colleagues and neighbors, this is incidental. So what is the mutation in chemistry? And I just given four of them. Tendency of chemists to monopolize small things and marking territory. You cannot have a conversation with a chemist for more than 15 minutes without a real conversation, without the chemist saying, my reaction, my reagent, my catalyst, my algorithm, my method. Why? Look at the big picture. And we mark territory. If somebody is working in the same area as yours, you consider him or her as an antagonist. Why? Yes, everybody has a right to mark territory. You know, in a forest, in a jungle, who marks territory? The famous animal who marks territory is a tiger. So, remember, if you are a tiger, you can mark your territory. But if you are not a tiger, don't venture to mark your territory, because you will have tough time to protect that territory. Second one, we chemists define ourselves very narrowly, unable to generate eye-catching things, big picture things. And therefore we must reflect within us, because things that happened in chemistry were lost to chemistry. Who conceptualized the idea and gave the methodology for genome sequencing? Craig Venter did it. He guided it. But it's all chemistry. When genome mapping took place, every step is embedded in chemistry. We talked today of nanoscience and technology this morning. You know, it was Harry Kroto's name was mentioned, that he gave us fullerene and C60 and all this. Who was it? Chemist. Started with chemistry. But today, chemists don't get enough credit, because we don't articulate it properly. We don't have the ownership of this, because we don't build our scenario around big things, big picture. Another disease that we chemists suffer from, creating for purpose. Sometimes, but mostly without purpose. We love making measurements, because the measurement has to be made. Because you got something, you make measurement. But we seldom ask, why are we measuring? And lastly, and I'm sure it will resonate among many of you here, many of you may not like to confess it, among scientists, chemists are least supportive of each other. You know, I know enough number of scientists in different disciplines. Chemists are not very generous to their son. Basically, they are not very generous to your colleagues. I think you can work it out in your mind, you know, people with whom you deal with and how you have suffered at their hands or how you had their problems. Okay, I leave it at that. Okay, so what is chemistry today? Molecular level view of everything and molecular creation is central to chemistry. And you come across these words these days, molecular machines, molecular gastronomy, which is very important for us Indians. There is enormous opportunity of applying molecular gastronomy to all our chaat, masala, what have you. And there is talk of molecular condoms. And I won't describe that, but I have given the PNAS May issue. you can read about what they are. Chemists create their own molecular cosmos. That is the greatest attribute of chemists. You don't need the physical world, physical cosmos, and so on and so forth. And actually, this was recognized way back in 1854. This famous French chemist, Auguste Laurent, had said, chemistry, in the 19th century, he said, chemistry has become today the science of bodies that do not exist. And what can be a better profession to create something that doesn't exist? You can study other disciplines, you can study biology, how living systems behave. You can look by telescope at heavenly bodies, as astrophysicists do. But who can create things that never existed? Even we predict what might exist tomorrow. That's the beauty, that's the pride of being a chemist and chemistry. Sorry. Ben Feringa, my good friend, winner of Nobel Prize in 2016, had said, the beauty of chemistry is that I can design my own molecular world. Very nicely said. Same thing is being said by many people, but I would like to amplify it further. Quote Berthollet, 19th century scientist, who says, chemistry creates its subject. The creative ability similar to that of arts essentially distinguishes chemistry among the natural and historical sciences. Uniqueness of chemistry is what is our inheritance. Okay, why I am talking about this molecular cosmos, I want you to know the size of the molecular cosmos. Can anybody tell me how many molecules are known? How many molecules are known? Okay, so if you use the tools of bioinformatics and in silico calculations, rather a very modest number, if you can make sense out of this number, that many number of compounds are possible. To me, this number means infinity, or very close to infinity, so I will not worry about this number. What I will worry, and perhaps this is the only structure I am going to show you, because 4 years ago, 3.5 years ago, we reached a landmark when SciFinder reported the 100 millionth compound in its registry. This was the compound. As of last week, 145 million compounds are known. And these are compounds which are in open access sources, which are characterized. But a much bigger number is in the repositories of companies which are patent protected. We don't even know how many have been made, because, you know, when you make a disclosure in the patent, you put this familiar trick that chemists play, put R, put X, and you say this many compounds, that many compounds. If you count all that, my estimate is that 500 million new chemical entities are known. That means in our world, there is one molecule at least for every 15 people. I think that's good enough. We don't need more. So if we keep on making compounds, we have to be a bit circumspect. Okay. The science has advanced so much. In chemistry, we are in a stage where just about any chemical can be accessed today. Question to ask, should we? Just because we can make, we should make it? The best thing to remember is, resource only what is needed for human advancement and well-being. And, of course, in risk-free, non-hazardous way, and so on. And the best way to move in that direction is to adopt new symbols of chemistry. New symbols of chemistry, I show here. SU and ID. Can anybody tell me what they are? Have you seen them in periodic table? You won't find them. But this is what we should adopt. SU is sustainability. And ID is interdisciplinarity. We have written again an essay in Nature Chemistry 2 or 3 years ago, where we have proposed that chemistry should adopt these new symbols. Okay. Something about teaching learning very quickly. Time has come for chemistry to create a new pedagogy, and we must endeavor to provide space in our teaching for systems thinking, which should be at the core, so that you don't have the problems as we face today with plastics. You must have read, microplastics are now even present in drinking water. Forget about fish eating plastic and so on, and our holy cow's stomach full of plastic and so on. It is acquiring serious challenge, and you know plastics was heralded as one of the top 10 discoveries of the 20th century. It got popularized, but the systems approach was not there. And this is fundamentally important for chemists, because in engineering you learn of systems approach very beginning, because you are moving parts. In biology, about 30 years ago, they started adopting systems approach in learning and in research. It is high time that in chemistry we adopt system-based approach, and I can give you many examples for that. We need in chemistry teaching and learning more contextualization. Chemistry is not something far away. Chemistry is within us. 40,000 enzymes, 40,000 enzymes are working round the clock in our body doing chemical reactions. And therefore, don't think that chemistry is for somebody else. Emphasize connections, adherence to ethical dimension, I will have few words to say about, and inculcate cultural competencies. So I'll move on, I'm already running out of my time. Again, we have proposed a new idea, what we call as New World Chemistry, along with, we are an international group of 4 people who are now committed to advancing, to safeguarding, to the extent we can help, the future of chemistry, and hopefully rejuvenate it in years ahead. So we have a website also, you can read about it. Okay. Chemistry's future as an ethical science. You know, American Chemical Society, a couple of years ago, came up what they call as Global Code of Ethics for every chemist. I think it's a very good document, because it begins to move away from the traditional ethics that we academics practice and teach students. You know, good things, be goody-goody, have good conduct, have transparency, have good collegiality, don't elbow your colleague in the lab, don't be unfair to the student, colleague, this, that. That is fine, that is ethical, that is very important. But don't make ethics in chemistry captive of individual behavior. Ethics in chemistry is a big picture. And therefore, I just marked here some key words which we should be aware of when we talk of ethics. Responsible practice of chemistry. And strong concern for environment and sustainability. Adopt scientific temper. Look everything critically, rationally, following the spirit of science. And we are very fortunate, we had a great Prime Minister of this country, Jawaharlal Nehru, who gave us this word to the world, scientific temper. Go and Google scientific temper and you will see that Nehru gave this word to the world. So basically is, you know, research integrity is important, I'll have something to say about it. But there are many more things which constitute in tomorrow's world ethical practices. One of them, of ethical practices, is diversity, value diversity. And we wrote a couple of months back, and again, an essay just appeared a few months back in Angwante Kemi, which is about importance of diversity in science and in chemistry. Most of us, you know, we have closed mind. We don't look at the world around. My molecule, my reaction, my reagent, my spectrum, my calculation. And chemistry is suffering, and therefore my plea to you that begin to learn diversity. You will begin to learn diversity if you will inculcate cultural competencies. Because cultural competencies